Hello everyone, this is BasketNews Talks. I'm the host, Donatas Rubinas, and today we're visiting Milan. And I want to introduce our next guest, Shavon Shields.
Thank you for having me.
Hello, Shavon. And I want to start with inspirations from your early days. And my first question is, who did inspire you for this? Maybe Dr. J? No?
No. I don't know. I didn't have an inspiration. It was just how I liked wearing my hair, and that's how I had it. So,
talking about basketball inspirations right now, I read that one of your idols was Paul Pierce.
Which
is also a bit unusual, no? Especially for the new generation players. So why did you like the truth so much?
I don't know. I felt like he was a good player, and just like the way he moved and things like that, I felt like I could emulate more than somebody who's, you know, crazy athletic or something like that. I felt like he related to me more, and I really liked his game a lot.
Yeah, do you agree that you kind of, you have the same moves and stuff like that? Because I read one tweet that you're kind of headband away from being Paul Pierce, actually.
I don't know about all that. I'm not as good as he was, but I emulate my game after him, and I really enjoyed watching him play and learning things from him. Mm.
From what I understood, you're probably the best inspiration was your dad, actually. And what's interesting that, he's the Hall of Famer of NFL, but he, as I understood, he made his career through the hard work ethic and discipline. What do you remember the most? What did you took from that experience watching him working so hard? What was his routine and which maybe you took for your career?
Yeah, I mean, during the season, he was usually gone before we got up for school at the facility doing treatments, watching film, all sorts of things, you know, putting in the time to become the best player he could be. And you know, ended up working out for him, and I take a lot after that to try to, you know, be professional, be responsible, show up on time, work hard, you know, do your job, and things usually work out for the best.
You also played for the Danish national team.
Yeah.
And Ife Lundberg is also another great EuroLeague player from Denmark. Do you remember that game against Lithuania where you were kind of one shot away from making the Eurobasket? You couldn't help the team at that moment, but maybe you watched it on TV.
Yeah, I watched it on TV, and that was a tough play to watch. I thought we had it, but came up a little short, and that happens sometimes in sports. But it was a great performance through the qualifiers for Denmark, and hopefully you know, we can figure something out to where we can all play and try to qualify for the country of Denmark, because I think it would be a pretty big accomplishment for, you know, Danish basketball and the country of Denmark. So.
Would you have played for in Eurobasket?
Yeah, for sure. I think that would be a awesome experience and a cool thing to be a part of.
Having you and Ife on the same national team already makes it intriguing, but let's put this in a hypothetical situation where you can add one EuroLeague player to the Danish national team. What do you think, who would upgrade your team to be, you know, a big time team in the tournament, for example, in Eurobasket? Probably you need a center.
We need a center. Yeah. So I'll go with Kyle. You just talk to Kyle. We'll take Kyle Hines.
But he's about to retire, so.
Hey, if we played this year, we'd take him. But yeah, I'll go with Kyle. We'll take Kyle. We need to send it.
Okay. Talking about Milan. Again, officially you were the, let's say, seventh official acquisition of Milan in summer 2020. But it seems like all these negotiations were ongoing before, right? It wasn't like late summer decision for you to move to Milan, right, from Basconia. What do you remember about that connection?
I mean, we were we had talked at the end of June, kind of previously, like right after we won the championship with Basconia, and you know, I liked what they were putting together here in Milan, and I wanted to be a part of it, so ended up making the decision to make the move over here to Italy, and it's worked out so far.
And what was that conversation with Etre Messina? Who he was talking
yeah,
with
I mean,
you
he
about
had
your role?
He has a big vision for this club, and you know, wants to compete for Final Fours and EuroLeague championships, compete for Italian championships, and you know, really build this into something special. So it was something I wanted to be a part of, and something that we're, you know, working every day to build together, and hopefully we'll get there sooner than later.
Yeah, what kind of vision he had for yourself, for example?
For me, I mean, I think with everybody he brings in, he wants them to, you know, obviously improve themselves personally as a basketball player, but obviously help the team as well. And everybody that has been a part of this and been a part of the team contributes to winning and you know, to the improvement that I was talking about. So it's been a great experience so far.
And that summer, Milan shook up the market with players like Kyle with the Tome, and there were many great signings. And what I want to say that probably many fans didn't expect you to be so efficient for that team. You became the second best scorer of Milan team, and the most efficient player in the EuroLeague for Milan. What I want to ask you, I mean, what made that kind of boost for you to make that kind of adjustment so quickly? I mean, you had a great season in Baskonia, for example, but I don't see many people who expected you to shine in Milan so fast.
Yeah, I mean, I gotta give credit to, you know, the coaches that we have here and my teammates. You know, they put me in great positions to be able to do that and be able to help and produce in that type of way. And, you know, without them, you know, people like Gigi, Kyle, Chacho, who have been around, done it, even Vlado Mikov, they've done it before. So, you know, they have the advice and the experience to say, hey, maybe you should do this here or look for this on this play, which is instrumental in, you know, developing and learning different aspects of the game and looking at it a different way. So honestly, I got to give all the credit to them.
And then you made the Final Four, and you were kind of one shot away from making the final, mm-hmm. actually. What do you remember the most about that last position?
I mean, Corey Higgins made a great shot over me. Full court contested a pull up, and you know, he made a great play, and they deserved the win on that night. So, you know, hopefully we can take one more step and make a championship game. But you know, right now we gotta focus on getting better each day and winning the game so that we can, you know, qualify for the playoffs and put ourselves in position to make that step.
And after such a game like that, what's like how Shavon Shields looks like, what he thinks about the next morning after such a game? How do you react in these situations?
I mean, after every game we play late, I stay up pretty late and, you know, replay the game, regardless if it's a good game or a bad game. So obviously, games that you lose or games that you don't play the way you want to are worse and longer nights. But you know, next day you gotta bounce back and try to you know, correct the mistakes and, you know, put a better foot forward the next day.
What replay you had, let's say, the most? It was your first Final Four experience. What do you think you could have done better? What did you take from that experience?
That's a good question. A lot. You know, there's a thin line between winning and losing. You know, it's a rebound there, a missed shot there, a missed box out, you know, a foul. It could be, there's a really, really thin line between winning and losing. And, you know, that day we were on the wrong side of it. And I think that's the biggest thing I took.
And the front office made some adjustments for another Final Four campaign, let's say. And we see Nicola Melli, we see Devin Hall, Dinos Mitoglou making big impact for the team so far. What do you like about them the most, talking about each of them? What do they add to the team?
You know, Nicola is really, he brings size, experience, you know, high basketball IQ, physicality, all sorts of things. He can shoot, he can pretty much do everything on the basketball court. And you know, he's going to be huge for us. He's obviously a captain and huge, a huge signing for us. So
how do you like his post up moves and all the footwork and stuff?
It's great. Yeah. Look good, huh?
Yeah.
No, it's great.
He plays like Dirk Nowitzki, actually.
So he's going to be huge for us. Devin, he's another playmaker on the court. He can score, defend, you know, 1-4, rebound. He's going to be big for us as well. And then Dinos is adding size, and he can shoot, rebound, you know, do all those things, play 4 and 5. So, you know, everybody that we've brought in, like I've said, has an opportunity to bring a big, big impact and, you know, take us to that next level.
Do you think that all these pieces will create you an opportunity to have a better shot at the championship?
I mean, that's the hope, and I think we're working in the right direction. You know, we started the season pretty well in EuroLeague and in the domestic league, and you know, we just got to keep building it day by day, and you know, hopefully at the end of the season we are where we want to be. So.
In one of your early interviews, I think it was in Italy, you mentioned that your ultimate goal in the end of the day is the NBA. Mm-hmm. And I talked to some people and they were kind of, you know, waiting for this August, actually, because if I'm correct, you had the NBA out or something like that. What do you think in general about your goal to be in the NBA? How do you try to reach it? Or when you play for the one of the best organizations in EuroLeague, you have a different approach for playing in the NBA?
Yeah, I mean, right now I think it's a disservice not only to me but my team if my head's you know, somewhere at where right now my head is here in Milan, where my feet are, and you know, trying to help win championships like I've said. And you know, it's if opportunity presents itself, then maybe, but right now I'm where I want to be, where I need to be. So you know, I'm happy with that.
We started with some inspirations, and then after you made it to the EuroLeague, after you made it to the Final Four, who inspires you the most at this age of your life, actually?
I mean, my family. I love my siblings, my brother and sister. They're great. My parents. You know, everything that I have and everything I am is because of them. And then, you know, I have a wife who I've been with since high school, and she's great. You know, keeps me grounded, takes care of everything. So, you know, they're definitely my biggest inspiration. And then my dogs. I love my puppies.
Dogs?
Yeah, I got some back home. But
what kind of dogs? I mean,
Labradoodles.
Okay.
Mixed between
Labradoodles. Yeah, they're the best.
So, yeah.
So do you have two dogs?
Well, family dogs. They're family dogs. Oh, they're okay. Not mine, but yeah.
Talking about your family, I mean, how all these siblings, your parents and stuff, how do they inspire you? I mean, what do they have which you like the most?
I mean, at the end of the day, I know that they, you know, love me unconditionally. You know, if I have a bad game, a good game, if you know, I bite their head off because, you know, I'm mad about something, you know, I know that they still love me and that they're still there for me no matter what. And you know, I take comfort in that, and I take you know, pride in representing them in the best way that I can. And so if I go out and do that, I think I take inspiration from them that way.
That was Shavon Shields, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. It was nice meeting you.
You can see all the interviews as well as this interview with Shavon Shields on BasketNews.com. You can find us on the BasketNews.com website and YouTube channel as well.